Russians are still in power. Now, some people believe that one of the things that the Russians are doing by beefing up their military presence there, opening new bases, etc., is that they want to be there when Assad goes, and they want to have a say in who his successor is, and they want to have greater influence in the whole Middle East region. And that certainly is the ulterior motive of Putin. And now I think the final point to make, and he said this last night in his interview with Charlie Rose, is that there are at least 2,400 fighters who are Russian citizens, largely from the North Caucasus, a few from other parts of Russia, who are fighting with Islamic State. It's the second largest contingent of foreign fighters. And when they come back to Russia, they contribute, obviously, to greater instability there. So he wants to try and stem that as well.
Dr. Sint, just want to challenge you a little bit on something you said just a moment ago having to do with President Bashar al-Assad of Syria. In the context of what has happened in Libya and in Egypt and what is currently going on in Iraq, why does it seem to be a fait accompli that the President Assad should not stay and will not introduce stability in the region?
Everybody is now saying he's going to stay for some time. A period of time, even Secretary Kerry has said that. No one's saying he has to go now, but the idea that he is a long-term solution to the problems of instability in Syria and holding Syria together as a country, I think that's very questionable.
But is it questionable in the context of what we've seen having gone through the Israel seemingly a similar issue in Libya with Gaddafi and also Mubarak in Egypt? I mean, has that created stability?
Of course it didn't, and obviously Libya is now, it's a completely dysfunctional state. We know what happened in Libya. So the question is, how are you going to balance the need for stability in Syria and keeping the country together, but to try and end a civil war, and again, the brutal treatment of the Syrian population, the use of chemical weapons and things like that, and end that so that you get greater stability.
Dr. Sint, before we let you go, we've had many, many voices this morning speak out on Ronald. And Dr. Sint, let me play a part of the conversation comment that Trump made about Syria and Russia.
Russia wants to get rid of ISIS. We want to get rid of ISIS. Maybe let Russia do it. Let him get rid of ISIS. What the hell do we care?
Okay, that's Syria. What do you do in Iraq with ISIS?
Look, with ISIS in Iraq, you got to knock them out.
How do you knock
them out? You got to fight them. You got to fight them.
On the ground.
Send it. If you need, you're going to have to do that. Yes.
Troops on the ground.
Yes.
And that's all, that's all many people say blustering talk from someone like Donald Trump or the other Republicans that we've heard. I mean, can the U.S. really back up that kind of tough talk?
Well, of course we share a common enemy. We would both like to get rid of Islamic State. We all agree on that. But if you go back, the only time since 9/11 when we've really been able to work with the Russians to defeat a common enemy, which is terrorism based on Islamic fundamentalism, it worked in the fall of 2001 when we had limited but common goals. It really hasn't worked since then. If you look at a variety of counterterrorism, cooperation and attempts to deal with these issues in the Middle East. And that's because we have very different goals from the Russians. Fundamentally, we don't trust each other. And, Russia wants to come out on top of this. So that's, history would suggest it's going to be very difficult. That doesn't mean you can't give it another try.
All right, Dr. Sint, thank you so much, Dr. Angela Sint there. And we're going to have much more on the Bloomberg Market Day.
Yes, coming up, a look at the market's decline. Stocks are falling, the S&P 500 down more than 1.5%.
What does the world run on? It runs on optimism. It's what sparks ideas, moves the world forward. Invest with those who see the world as unstoppable, have the curiosity to look beyond the easement, and the conviction to begin it for the long term. Oppenheimer Funds believes that's the right way to invest in this big, bold, beautiful world.
In today's equity markets, are there any opportunities left? There's three things to consider even more attractive than their bond. order, particularly given the European Central Bank's unprecedented stimulus program. And with a stronger U.S. dollar and weaker euro, it's been a tailwind to large European exporters, particularly in Germany.
Call 1-800 iShares to request a prospectus, which includes investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information that you should read and consider carefully before investing. Investing involves risk, including possible loss of principal.
Wondrous new technology that makes you think, how is that possible? New ventures, new ways of thinking about community, shareholders, stakeholders, working with visionary companies. Morgan Stanley is helping bring bold ideas to life. Not just to create wealth, but to create change.
a little gloomy and ominous outside, which reflects what is going on in the stock market right now. Basically red across the board, as you can see at the bottom of your screen there. Welcome back to the Bloomberg Market Day. I'm Betty Lou. Let's get a look at the stories making the headlines at this hour. Residential real estate hit a speed bump last month. Pending sales of previously owned homes unexpectedly fell in August for just the second time this year. Inventory is low, leading to higher prices, and that is hurting demand. And Americans may be divided on a number of Supreme Court rather than force sell Republicans into voting on a measure on his future as Speaker.
Winning that vote was never an issue. I was going to get the overwhelming number of, I got 400 votes from it. Why do I want to make my members, Republican members, like walk the plank? Because they're going to be criticized at home by some who would, would think that we ought to be more aggressive.
Well, California Congressman Kevin McCarthy is likely to be the next speaker. He's currently number two in the Republican leadership. And that is a look at the top stories at this hour. And of course, one of the big stories of the day is the market action. We've woken up this morning and it is not pretty at all in almost all of the markets. Bloomberg's Ramey Innocencio has an update. Ramey?
Hey there, Betty. Yeah, I'd say good afternoon, but it's not really good afternoon if you're going long in these stocks. It is a red morning, red afternoon right now. We're seeing our fifth straight day of declines. Turns out the S&P and NASDAQ are falling to their lowest in a month. Take a look at the numbers. The S&P 500 are down nearly 2%. The NASDAQ, the biggest loser, down by 2.2%. One interesting thing about the S&P is that it has never seen a five-day losing streak in 2014. We are seeing that today. China and its slowing economic growth is a large part of the reason for this. New data out of China showed industrial profits were down 8.8% in August. That was its biggest drop in at least the past 4 years. All right, dive into my Bloomberg terminal. Let's check out the health of the S&P's 10 sectors. And if you think red is healthy, well, then you're in luck because it is red across the board right now. Healthcare and materials are down the most by nearly 3% here. Turns out the healthcare and biotech really have been struggling lately. Healthcare is lower for a seventh day, and it's seen its longest streak as well in 4 years, longest losing streak there. Let's also take a look at biotech shares. They are falling for a seventh day in a row as well. The biotech ETF by SPDR is down by 5.1% there, and the NASDAQ Biotech Index, the NBI, is down by about 4.4% today. This index right here has lost nearly 90% of its value in about the last 10 days or so. And you'll remember the reason why is when Hillary Clinton just railed on the healthcare industry in a Twitter post. She talked about how price controls are needed after an HIV drug price was hiked by about 5,000%. Right now, 142 of 144 stocks on this index are down today. All right, let's take a look at some other stocks in the sector. Some of the companies impacted here are Gilead Sciences. Gilead Sciences is Biogen as well as Sells for Centier.
Order
These
filled.
Biotech stocks account for
Order
almost 40% of the index weighting. Gilead is seeing its worst day in a month right there. Let's move right along and let's go on over to our next thing, which is Apple as well as Facebook, from biotech to tech. And they are the worst performers on the S&P today. That's despite opening weekend iPhone sales that blew away estimates for Apple. It's down 1.5%, but they did say that they sold 13 million new 6S and 6S Plus units versus 10 million units of prior model last year. Facebook shares also having the worst day of the month, down by 3.8% this year after German Chancellor Angela Merkel questioned the company's efforts in restricting racist posts. Facebook shares actually have been down only just 5 trading days this month, but as you can see, down by about 3.7%, shedding a little bit of those losses from earlier. Guys, back to you.
Okay, well, we're certainly going to keep our eye on Apple. Ramey, thank you so much. Ramey Innocencio there with a look
order,
at how the markets
order,
are.
Bill.
You want to make sure you stay on top
order,
of their
bill.
Movement today. Well, coming up in the next half hour, the UN General Assembly, as you know, in New York right now, and I had a chance to sit with Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, as you see there, Angela Merkel, Bono, oh, there I am, on what went down at this high-powered roundtable. Not sure why I was there. Apple is out with a record, as you just heard from Ramey, new iPhone sales. We're going to take a look at what is driving that strength. Still ahead on the Bloomberg Market Day, Shell ditching Alaska in a surprise announcement. Is this the end of the Arctic ambitions for oil? We're going to discuss that in a moment.
One dress, working with visionary companies. Morgan Stanley is helping bring bold ideas to life. Not just to create wealth, but to create change.
In today's equity markets, are there any opportunities left? There's three things to consider with Europe. Valuations are more attractive than the U.S. marketplace. Valuation of dollar and weaker euro has been a tailwind to large European exporters, particularly in Germany.
Call 1-800-iShares to request a prospectus, which includes investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information that you should read and consider carefully before investing. Investing involves risk, including possible loss of principal.
This is a story of outdoors, the artificial heart, electric guitars, and rockets to the moon. It's the story of America, land of the doers.
Doing it, did it, done.
Doers built this country, the dams and the railroads.
And great loss of speed.
They built the Golden Gates and the Empire State. And all this doing takes energy, no matter who's doing.
There's all kinds of doing up in here.
Or what they're doing. What the heck's he doing? Energy got us here. And it's our job to make sure there's enough to keep doers doing the stuff doers do. To keep us all doing what we do.
Welcome back to the Bloomberg Market Day. I'm Betty Lou. You just heard from Ramey all the market action that is going on here right now in the U.S. But there was a lot that started in Asia. Chinese industrial numbers came out. Chinese industrial companies, seeing profits drop at the fastest pace in at least 4 years. Bloomberg's David Ingalls filing this report from Hong Kong.
This quarter, the Chinese economy has really hit industrial profits hard as a group. Earnings fell close to 9% in August from the year before, which translates to the sharpest decline in 4 years. Obviously, not all the industries are created equal. So within the group, actually, we have the worst performing lot there. Those with exposed mix of resources, mining, traditional heavy industries declined 10 to 15%. On the other hand, though, you have the likes of pharmaceuticals, telcos, and utilities still reporting fairly modest improvements. Now, the reasons for the decline, government said, are things like falling prices, low returns on their balance sheets for investments, and you also have foreign losses, each of which, of course, was fairly unsurprising given.
Now, look at the top stories. And this afternoon, Taco Bell wants to expand on the success of its mobile app. The restaurant chain has unveiled a new website allowing customers to place orders, pay for them, and find a new nearby Taco Bell. The company says customers using the mobile app spend more than $10 on an average order, 20% higher than those who order in person, so it's on their app. NASA just solved a major mystery on Mars. Guys, get excited on this. They announced today evidence of liquid water on the red planet. Scientists believe liquid water is a necessary precursor to life. The planet has been known for years to have ice, and its surface shows signs of ancient water flow, but the latest research is the first to provide compelling evidence for the ongoing existence of flowing water. Elon Musk might get his wish to go to Mars and find life. Okay, cyclist Lance Armstrong goes full circle in a long-running court case. After resisting for years, he's apologizing to a Dallas promotions company and paying back $10 million it gave him. The company paid him bonuses for his Tour de France win, but the promoter said he should pay it back when his use of performance-enhancing drugs was proven to be true. And Hotel Transylvania 2 scared away the competition at the box office this weekend. Yes, it did. The family flick about vampires earned more than $47 million, a record for a September debut weekend. In second place with $18 million, The Intern starring Robert De Niro. And that is a look at some of the top stories at this hour. Now, we have been following closely the commodities route this morning. World Dutch Shell adding to debt, announcing that it's pulling out of Alaska. The company says it's going to cease further offshore activity there after $7 billion of spending failed to produce any major successes. Back in July, I caught up with Shell President Marvin Odom in Aspen. Here's what he told me about what drives the company's ambition.
We're not actually driven by top-line production numbers. We're driven by value. So We're happy to sell the assets that we don't necessarily want to keep in the portfolio. We constantly work to high-grade that portfolio. And if that means production falls for periods of time, that's actually fine, because we're doing the right value thing for the company.
Well, Shell and its peers have been working to curb spending after the price of oil slumped about 50% in the past year alone. For more, we are joined by Philip Kladick, the senior oil here in what Marvin Odom just said, and now matching that with their announcement in Alaska. It all makes sense?
Yeah, well, Arctic is a high risk and high reward business, so if you don't find enough quantities, and obviously they didn't, then it's not worth it. And if you look, most of the other projects in the world have been stalled as well, only any going forward with this project in Norway. So there's only a few companies left that can really do projects like this.
So is this the end, though, of Arctic oil?
Well, it depends. If there's really a technologic breakthrough and they really manage to replace offshore platforms by sea floor installations only, that's one thing, for example, that the Norwegians are trying to develop that makes oil platforms redundant, this could bring the industry forward. I mean, not only the higher oil price will do this, because you have to make sure that the public is okay with drilling in the Arctic.
Right. I mean, this was opposed certainly by plenty of environmentalists pursuing this. But did it have to take, Phil, $7 billion worth of spending before Shell made this decision?
Well, Shell said that this province, this area, would potentially have as much oil as half of the Gulf of Mexico. So the reward is there, but it's also high risk. And we today saw the downside of this risk.
We certainly saw the downside of that risk. Now, Marvin Odom, when we were there at the Aspen conference, they had just announced more development in the Gulf of Mexico and what a big potential there is in that area for oil for them. So in some ways, is that discovery or that project going to help offset their pullout of the Arctic Circle?
Well, Shell, as many other big oil companies, has a portfolio of several potential assets that they could develop. And, well, one didn't work out, but Shell is usually sufficiently diversified across the globe to develop one of these assets. And normally the risk is so that one of these assets will become a high potential development.
Okay, so what happens next for Shell? What is this pullout going to mean? And you know, what kind of costs are associated with that, Phil, and what happens for Shell?
Well, this is part of the business. Oil reserves is just becoming increasingly expensive, and big companies like Shell, they just need to go for the big impact plays. So they need to go to the Arctic, they need to go to deep sea offshore Brazil or deep sea offshore Africa. These are the kind of plays that big companies like Shell need to go after to be able to cover their costs.
And is there, Phil, before we go, is there any sense at all in the United States, because we've heard so much about production not easing up given the price, given the decline in oil prices, that production might be finally leveling off? Is there any sense of that right now in the U.S.?
Well, we haven't seen the end of this yet, so it's very difficult to see how cost-efficient shale producers will become, how cost-efficient unconventional will become. This is a very new technology, and it's just in the middle of being developed. So we haven't seen the end of where actually the cost efficiency will stop.
Order rejected.
Okay, so thank you so much, Phil Kladick, the senior oil and gas analyst at Bloomberg Intelligence in London on Shell, no longer drilling in the Arctic Circle. Much more ahead on the Bloomberg Market Day. Mark Zuckerberg is among those in New York for the UN General Assembly. Had a chance to sit with him along with Angela Merkel and Bono for a wide-ranging conference and event. We're going to tell you what exactly happened there, what Facebook announced.
In today's equity markets, are there any opportunities left? There's three things to consider with Europe. Valuations are more attractive than the U.S. marketplace. Valuations in equities are more attractive than their bonds, particularly given the European Central Bank's unprecedented stimulus program. And with a stronger U.S. dollar and weaker euro, it's been a tailwind to large European exporters, particularly in Germany.
Call 1-800 iShares to request a prospectus, which includes investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information that you should read and consider carefully before investing. Investing involves risk, including possible loss of principal.
Ready to go to Wild World. built for families, designed.
It was quite refreshing just to see the way she handled it. And it was inspiring. It really was. There was not a sad day in our house. I'll tell you right now, there was not a sad day.
About the Chinese economy, but also Syria, how do you get that up there in prominence? I think it's a question of, you know, what do we need to do today? You know, all of these immediate things that are pressing in on political leaders, and I know what that feels like from personal experience, but also what do we need to do today to build for the longer term? And the evidence is absolutely clear. If you educate particularly girls, but if you educate a population, the nation will be more prosperous. People are more likely to believe in the benefits of democracy. People are more likely to be tolerant of other religions. So we need to make these investments now. And I increasingly feel, and I'm delighted by this, that we are pushing against an open door. I've been in and around the UN for the last few days. The Pope made the very strong point that all of the sustainable development agenda is only achievable if we invest in education. Right. It's the great enabler. So we need to see more financing. And to give you a statistic there, it costs on average $1.18 a day to educate a child in a developing country. That's primary school and secondary school. $1.18 a day. Not a lot of money. We've all spent more on coffee than that. And the gap between what developing countries finance and that whole $1.18 is 14 cents.
Order.
14 cents per child per day.
Madam Prime Minister, what do you say, though, there are regimes in this world who feel that young girls, that young women should not have educational opportunities, that they should basically stay at home, and that this is a male domain? You know this for a fact, that there are places on this earth who don't believe that women should have equal rights.
There most certainly are, and persistence matters, courage matters. The example of Malala is such a huge example for our world. But I can tell you from practical experience where we're working, countries like Afghanistan, which I visited as Prime Minister, we had troops fighting there, countries like Yemen, hard places where many people don't believe in educating their daughters. We've been able, with our developing country partner government, to work in communities and to get
Order rejected.
So I'm really pleased that that change is possible.
Yeah.
We've just got to keep doing it, keep rolling it out, keep...
Order rejected.
And for very poor families, it's often an economic equation as much as a cultural equation, so school feeding programs can make a difference.
In the midst of one of the biggest declines we've seen in the commodity markets right now,
we
flash back to 2011 here in Australia, is such a commodity-reliant